Hey guys, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about cyclohexane chair conformations.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So it's going to be very important to be able to describe the conformations of cyclic compounds, especially cyclohexane, because it is so prevalent in organic chemistry. So what we want to do is take a look at what we have here and understand that there are many possible conformations for cyclohexane, but they all have different energies, and the one that is at the lowest energy is the chair conformation. The reason that the chair conformation is at the lowest energy is because it allows for flawless tetrahedral geometry with 109.5 degree bond angles at every center, and if we look closely, it's all staggered interactions. Everything that we see here involves staggered interactions between neighboring groups. So this is the lowest energy, and cyclohexane will spend the most time in this conformation. So what we want to do is be able to draw chair conformations. Let's take a look at how to do that. So when we draw cyclic molecules in line notation, we're used to drawing them in this top-down view, like this. But just as with Newman projections, we had to rotate our perspective to be able to assess conformations. We're gonna have to do the same thing with these molecules. So what we wanna be able to do is draw them edge on. So what we need to understand is that there are two carbon molecules, this guy and this guy, that are in the plane of the board, but that there are two that are closer to us than the rest. That would be these two in the front. And then there are two at the back that are further away from us than the rest. And that would be these two. And then the hydrogen atoms are going to be oriented in a way that obeys tetrahedral geometry. So at first, a lot of these lines and angles may seem very arbitrary, but what we want to be able to do is see the pyramid at each spot here. So each of these carbons is sp3 hybridized tetrahedral geometry, and that's what we can see here with this model, right? These are all, this is meant to reflect the geometry at each of these carbons here. Now, it can be tricky at first to draw chairs, so just to point out a few things, the reason it's called a chair is because it kind of looks like a chair, and you could almost imagine somebody lying there and sunning themselves and having a lovely day. Now, a couple of common mistakes I see, we've got bow tie syndrome. This is no good. We do not want to draw bow ties, nor do we want to draw lightning bolts. So let's cross these out here. That's no good. We don't want the bow ties. We don't want the lightning bolts. In fact, we don't want any of the lines on the chair to even approach verticality. If you have vertical lines on your chair, it's not going to work out, because we need to be able to look at a chair and be able to tell which is the leftmost and which is the rightmost carbon. So here, that's not going to work, right? Over here, this works very clearly. That's the leftmost carbon, that's the rightmost carbon, and so that is going to be the best way for us to be able to assess certain things about these conformations. So let's take a look at something called a chair flip and what happens when that occurs. So I've redrawn a cyclohexane chair here, and you're going to want your chairs to look exactly like this. So a quick tip, the chair is comprised of three sets of parallel lines. This line and this line should be essentially parallel. These lines should be parallel, and these lines should be parallel. And all the things I mentioned before apply. Remember, we want to be able to clearly see which is the leftmost and which is the rightmost carbon, because that's going to enable us to keep track of things when we flip the ring. So let's take a look also at the substituents on the ring. We have all of these hydrogens. We have 12 hydrogens, right? Now, each carbon on the ring is going to have one group projecting up from the ring and one group projecting down from the ring. In addition, each carbon is going to have an axial substituent and an equatorial substituent. Now, for axial, you can think of this as lying on a vertical axis. That might help you remember. And so the red hydrogens on the left are the axial hydrogens. Those are projecting directly up or down vertically from the ring. The green ones here are the equatorial. You can think of them almost as lying more nearly to the equator, let's say, of the molecule. So notice how those are angled. Now, this seems relatively arbitrary, but once again, as I said before, these angles are very specific because they represent the tetrahedral geometry that is occurring at every sp3 hybridized carbon. So we must illustrate the 109.5 degree bond angles. So these groups all have to be projecting exactly this way. If you had a hydrogen atom, for example, going vertically upwards at that position, that would be wrong because that would be defying the tetrahedral geometry of the chair. So I know at first it seems a little bit arbitrary, but you really must have them look exactly like this, okay? So notice as well that the axial position changes upwards or downwards on alternating carbons. That may help. On carbon one, it's up. On carbon two, it's down, and so forth. So this is exactly how you want to draw the chair. Now, let's talk about what is happening when the chair flips to the other chair conformation. Now, unfortunately, it's very hard to illustrate with these models, so you can perhaps find an animation online that will show you what is happening, but this is a very, very common thing students to misunderstand. What we need to understand is that these bonds are constantly rotating, and because of that, these carbons sort of shift upwards and downwards with respect to each other, generating other conformations. And at the end of it, you get the other chair conformation. So when we draw the other chair conformation, it's very tempting to think that what has happened is simply a rotation or something like that, but that in fact is not what it is. What is happening, it is that each carbon is being pushed upwards or downwards. So in order for the chair to flip to the other chair conformation, this carbon is being pushed down, these are being pushed up, these are being pushed down, and this one is being pushed up. And so the carbons are all in the same relative positions, but now carbon one is downwards, carbon four is upwards, etc. So I've numbered the carbons to make it perfectly clear which carbons are which. Over here is carbon one, so that's going to stay the leftmost carbon. Over here is carbon four, that's going to stay the rightmost carbon. Carbons two and three are away from us. These are the carbons that are further from us than the board, so those will remain in those positions. And carbons five and six are the ones that are closer to us than the rest of the molecule, and so those will remain closer. So that is what is happening with the chair flip, and again, I suggest you look at an animation to better visualize what is going on, but it is not simply a rotation, it is actually a shifting of every atom with respect to one another. Okay, so what is happening to the substituents when we perform the ring flip? So, in fact, what happens is that every group that was axial will now be equatorial, and every group that was equatorial will now be axial. So let's take a look at carbon one. We've got the hydrogen that is axial here. Now, as this carbon gets shifted down, what's going to end up happening is that goes down too, but now will be assigned to the equatorial position. Whereas the hydrogen that was equatorial, as carbon one gets pushed down, will now assume the axial position. So we can see that that is what is happening on each one of these carbons, and it is certainly a rule that any group that is axial in one chair conformation will be equatorial in the other, and vice versa. So this should help you be able to draw both chair conformations for any given cyclohexane molecule. Now that we know each chair has axial and equatorial substituents, we need to understand a little bit about the energetic discrepancy between these positions. So if we take a look here, let's say we're looking at these three groups that are in the axial positions on their respective carbons. We need to understand that there is an element of steric hindrance contained in these positions by these diaxial interactions. So what we need to understand is that groups in the axial positions have an opportunity to create more steric hindrance than the groups in the equatorial positions, because the groups in the equatorial positions are anti with respect to the rest of the ring, being the bulkier group. So the equatorial position is the lower energy position. The axial position is the higher energy position. Now what that means is that if we look at a substituted cyclohexane molecule, one of the chairs may be at a lower energy than the other one, and therefore the molecule will spend more time in that lower energy chair, which is going to be important for us to know to be able to predict reaction kinetics and things like that. So let's take a look at just methyl cyclohexane. Now let's say we've put a methyl group here on this carbon. In this particular chair, the carbon is in the equatorial position, projecting upwards from the rightmost carbon. Now, when we flip the ring, remember that this carbon gets pushed down, these get pushed up, these get pushed down, and this one gets pushed up. And so this carbon will still be the rightmost carbon, and the methyl group will still be projecting up from the ring. However, equatorial becomes axial and axial becomes equatorial when you flip the ring. So this equatorial methyl group will now be axial. Now, given what we said about the energetic discrepancy between equatorial and axial positions, it should be easy for us to figure out that this chair is going to be the more energetically favorable because the singular substituent is in the equatorial position rather than the axial. So whereas this would be generating diaxial interactions and therefore more steric hindrance, in this case it is not, so this chair will be at a lower energy. Now let's look at a disubstituted cyclohexane. So here on the left we have a methyl group projecting upwards in the axial position, and then we have a tert-butyl group projecting upwards in the equatorial position. Now, when we flip the ring, remember what we said about each group staying on the same carbon. So this would be, let's say we number this like this. So we've got a methyl on 3, so that will remain on 3, and as it was projecting upwards from the ring, it will still be up from the ring. However, axial, when that carbon moved down, became equatorial. And then this tert-butyl group, as it was projecting up, will remain up, but where it was equatorial, it will now be axial. Now, so in each case, we have one substituent axial and one substituent equatorial. However, they do not contribute the same amount of steric hindrance because a tert-butyl group is a much larger, bulkier group. So we will place a higher premium on that group being equatorial over the smaller methyl group. So given these two options here, this is going to be the lower energy chair conformation because it places the bulkier tert-butyl group in the equatorial position. So even though this methyl is axial, it's okay because in this chair, the tert-butyl group is axial, and that is going to generate a lot more steric hindrance. So this is the worst of the two. So now we should be able to assess the different energies of the different chair conformations. And I also want to point out there is often a lot of confusion and a desire to try to assign up or down or cis or trans with axial and equatorial. And that's something that we shouldn't do. So we should not associate that terminology with one another. So for example, here, this methyl and this tert-butyl group are cis to one another, but that in no way implies that the two groups would both be axial or equatorial, or that one would be axial or equatorial. In fact, if I moved this methyl group over one, the up position on this carbon would be equatorial. So simply by moving one substituent to another carbon, it would still be cis. They would still be cis with respect to one another. However, they would then both be equatorial. So there is absolutely no correlation between cis and trans or up and down from the ring and whether those substituents are axial or equatorial. In fact, every single substituent on a cyclohexane chair will be axial in one of the two chairs and will be equatorial in the other necessarily. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.